Mi compañera Rocío. My name is Jennifer Maldonado. I go by J-Mo. I'm an alumna of Sereno Middle School, Woodrow Wilson High School, and also UC San Diego, and I'll be your moderator for tonight's event. And I'd like to also introduce Principal Dara, and she'll do the welcoming, and then we'll pass it on to Principal Martinez. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome. I'm so happy to see so many of you here. I wish we had more people here. I think this is such an important event, and I'm so honored to be the principal of this school that is so steeped in such important history in this community. This story of activism is so important, and it's such a great backdrop for our school. We are an IB world school, and our scholars work really hard to be principled and to be reflective and open-minded. So this is the perfect space for them to practice those attributes. So welcome, thank you to everybody. There's so many of you up here who have played a part in making this happen. I look forward to the series of events to honor this important story to our community and to our lives and our future lives and future generations. So I would like to introduce the current principal of Wilson. You know, if you don't know, we're here because this school was Wilson High School, which is now the middle school. And so I'd like to welcome the principal of Wilson High School, Mr. Martinez.
So I am the proud principal of Wilson High School. I am the proud principal of Wilson High School. It's with great honor that I'm here to hear stories, to see taking back our schools again. It gives me great honor to be principal of the legacy center. Because so much was created out of that movement, out of that social movement, so many changes were made. And to be honest, I was a Chicano Studies major. So I have a bachelor's and a master's in Chicano Studies from Cal State Northridge. And I don't think that I would have been given that opportunity had these movements not happened in the 60s. And with the students walking out and the students really fighting and advocating for education, what an honor it is to be at a school that was actively involved. They fought for graduation, to increase graduation rates. Currently, Wilson, we graduated 91% of our students. Amazing. So we are to get ahead, to move forward, and be those agents of change, because those little seeds that you guys already planted are starting to blossom. So I'm very proud to be principal. Thank you very much. And next, I'd like to introduce from board member Monica Garcia's office, Isidro Armenta,
Hello everyone, my name is Isidro Armenta. On behalf of Board President Monica Garcia, she absolutely is privileged to be part of the legacy. I know we touched base with Bobby and Yoli on several occasions, and many more to come in the next couple of weeks, and even the unknown participants of the walkouts that made sure that those demands were heard 50 years later. On behalf of Board President Garcia and the entire Board of Education, she is thankful and grateful that she is able to be Board President because of the actions 50 years ago. And here being here at the Old Wilson, and so it's fun. Can you raise your hands if you were, if you came here as a Wilson student? Well, that's super awesome. Thank you all so much for being here. As I said, we have, and we would like to hear more of your stories. This is basically a homecoming, an alumni gathering for everyone. Then, up until now, we have a website that's achieve.lausd.net/vision2068, and that is our commemoration website. Please go there, share your story. We want to record it, we want to celebrate it, and we want to make sure that it's heard. So thank you very much on behalf of the board president, and I'll hand it back to Jamie.
Thank you so much. So before we begin our documentary, we would like to highlight and give much thanks to our community for also making this event possible. El Vaquero, La Cocina del Sereno, El Desierto Verde, Holy Grounds Coffee and Tea, Food for Less, Castillo's Herbs and Vitamins, Clarita's Restaurants, and Latinos Tax Income, for donating the waters, for giving monetary donations, the snacks, and all that you see outside was donation-based, so we really want to thank them for contributing to this event as well. And also, J-Inks Clothing, who did our awesome t-shirts, and we did the design, and you know, they did the labor and created a screen out of it. And we'll have 50 t-shirts at every event for the first 50 people. You know, it's free for them, so that you all get to walk away with, you know, a memory, or you know, wear this proudly. And for folks who haven't seen it, it's basically like protest students, and then also students graduating. It says all the high schools, and then it says South Castro's quote, go to college and graduate. So we really want to thank all of you for spending your evening with us, and we hope you enjoy the show. So we can go ahead now and thank Gilbert Telecom for doing our sound, and just holding it down, making sure the visuals were good, and also the mariachi group, the student mariachi group, and just El Sereno Middle School, you know, for being very open to this event and collaborating with us from the beginning. And as you can see, you know, before, a lot of people came together to make these events possible. The next event will be March 1st. It's a Thursday from 3 to 5:30 right here in front of El Sereno Middle School, and we will be unveiling a plaque as well as a mural. And we will also have an opportunity for people to participate in drawing the mural and painting in the mural. So please make sure to put that on your calendars. A lot of good events to come forward. Thank you so much, and we hope you enjoy the documentary.
Languages. normal, but bad, but you didn't have a choice. You were attracted to those areas. Students were grouped into the classes, generally based on some kind of ability rating, usually it was IQ. The lower groups didn't get the same medal.
Over half of all the Mexican-American children it's about, the Mexican. And consequently, there's a myth that the Mexican is pliable, he is non-resistant, and that anybody can do anything to him that anybody wishes. Well, this isn't true. But now that he's become an urban Mexican, and now that there's a more numerous generation of...
Dr. Ernesto Galarza, a longtime labor activist and educator, says the traditional perceptions of the Mexican-American community were about to be challenged.
The tensions within the Mexican community are increasing, and they show themselves in the current protest movements.
Despite the earlier efforts to improve education, a half century of frustration was about to explode in the East Los Angeles schools.
This was a time in which enough Chicano students had gained mastery of the tools that were necessary to shake up the system, and had taken the ideals of the country to heart. And so we protested for our rights.
Was the political evolution of a group of young Chicanos in East LA, from being involved in community civic-minded activities as young citizens from community action, and then becoming culturally aware of their background, their history, their race, becoming young Chicanos from community action, and asserting their real identity, and then getting involved, realizing that the system would change unless you became more direct action.
During that time, we were building support. We were all talking to other students at campuses, we were talking to teachers, people were talking to their parents. We were building support in the community.
I was a first-year graduate student, and I was involved in the initial organizing of UMAS, which stands for the United Mexican American Students. And we had begun to talk with other leaders in the area of the campuses that we needed to commit ourselves as college students to the betterment of our community, and in particular to changing things with the betterment of our sisters and brothers in the high schools, for example, in the elementary schools.
Sal Castro, an outspoken history teacher, helped to organize the students.
For years, the schools have rapped very lamely. Mexican homes were not doing a good job in educating the kid. In other words, if the kid doesn't go to school, it's Mexican parents' fault or the Mexican homes' fault. But I've yet to see a Mexican kid come into school at the age of 5 or 6 years of age, not knowing the language.
Castro grew up in East Los Angeles, where he learned firsthand the problems within these schools.
He has learning readiness, he's ready to learn when he walks into school. So it's not the fault, it's never been the fault of a Mexican home.
His activism was shaped by vivid memories from his youth. In the 1930s, Sal's father was deported to Mexico, part of a U.S. repatriation program provoked by the Great Depression. In the 1940s, he witnessed the Zoot Suit Riot, when U.S. soldiers and sailors attacked Mexican Americans in the streets of Los Angeles. By the spring of 1968, Sal Castro knew clearly what he was up against.
Most teachers will go to Mexico with a negative attitude that you have nothing to give to me. I am going to make you an angle, come hell or high water, and whatever you have to say about it makes no difference.
We have to now say the schools are not working. They're taking our taxpayers' money, the hard money that our fathers and mothers worked for, and not returning it anyway. We're the only ones losing out.
A massive walkout to shut down the schools. But what we somehow decided on, change wasn't going to come from within, it had to come from without.
How many people were right to do it, and who was going to do it? Because I think decided that point for a lot of us, including.
Sitting in class, everyone was aware this was going to happen.
The signal was going to be
the hallway saying, lockout, lockout. And I remember looking at him and thinking, my God, am I really going to do this?
They commit to have done. Did they have a legitimate complaint?
and demanded a meeting with school board members.
I cannot tell the Board of Education to come. My feeling is that the members of the Board of Education will be happy to come and talk with you.
Now, what I'm saying to you is that I realize your limitations, but I'm also saying that we, the students, are demanding that they come. We are always asking you for related information.
And I know Gary's been trying to talk to us, but he didn't have anything to say. What can he say to us? And so the students got up there and spoke, and there was this tremendous energy and fervor. There was an excitement that we actually pulled it off. Despite opposition, walkout leaders from Eastside schools forged a united front.
And let's hope to have a meeting with the school board, and they take care of us. Well, the best way to go, let us know. And we don't want to be students from going.
My decision to walk out was probably the lightest decision in terms of what I probably would have liked to have done at that point. That kind of youth and energy and anger.
That's right. We're not going to be here by summer school all night in trouble, right?
The walkouts continued. Tensions increased.
Police were not kind to high school students.
that somebody would get hurt.
We knew what the danger was, we could see it. But we also couldn't stop it. They were already there. They were doing it themselves. So it just spurred us on to get these reforms going so that we cool off.
School authorities began to pressure the striking students. The kids are getting now getting calls from principals that they're going to be suspended, that they're going to be expelled, that anybody that was headed for college and had grants or scholarships, the scholarships were to be taken away. We needed some public official to say the kids are ready.
We all went to go meet Bobby Kennedy on the day he was about to go meet Cesar Chavez, who was undergoing his fast at the point, to request that he support our efforts, which he did, and which he was very, generous with his words, and very offered us positive support.
He knew all about the walkouts. He had a list of our demands. He asked us a couple of questions, and he told us that he supported everything that we did.
Parents concerned for their children's future became actively involved.
We are not going to allow this situation to continue. We are not going to let young people below the age of 18 do the work that belongs to us.
As their children had done, they asked to meet with school officials. Their request was denied.
Seems that our voices are not heard.
What else has the left for us to do? All we can do is support them. We've been 3 weeks trying to find more educators who understand the meaning of lack of respect. The respect of the people is the past.
It's a real place where our movement is going to definitely demonstrate its full potential. That strike was here in the city. For the first time, what was more significant is not what individuals were doing, but what masses of people were doing. And that's what the walkouts demonstrated. Our movement was not a movement of a cadre, of individuals, of organizations, but a mass involvement.
Men and women of the Mexican American community.
3 weeks later, the school board bowed to pressure and agreed to meet with parents.
We have allowed our young people to get the short end of the stick for too long.
Counselors who have been completely negligent in their jobs for
indictment of the Los Angeles schools, of all the schools in the Southwest, which Chicanos have gone to for years, and where the schools have failed miserably in teaching them. They will be indicted, and they will be convicted. And in the long run, our kids will win. The Mexican will win. The United States will win. All of us. And all of us. Gracias.
We started 13 with the first political trial that you ever opened. All of a sudden now, we had a real power ahead, and we had some very, very good, dedicated people that were going to be given a terrible time, of course, and possibly a criminal record for trying to make the city and the state do its job better.
I think that the community recognized that that arrest was designed to stop this movement. And so we knew that we had to come to their defense. It was just another thing they were throwing at us that we had to surmount.
The reason for the interest of the American Civil Liberties Union in this case is that the indictment charges no more than acts of urging others, for instance, to engage in a boycott of the schools. In our view, such urging is fully protected by the First Amendment, and the prosecution violates the Constitution.
The entire conduct of these proceedings has been a political harassment. An outright political attack on the entire Mexican-American community, directly and indirectly on all of the rest of us, because our civil rights are involved too. This demonstration is a poor man's printing press, and his right to use it is going to be as inviolable as a rich man's right to print his newspaper, or else our talk about free speech is just a mantra.
It's well, not you, see that Chief Red, Long Angeles Police Department have mistook community service.
The LA 13 were released on bail on Monday, June 3rd, 1968. With their release was overshadowed by the assassination of Robert F. Kennedy 2 days later. The Chicano movement was suddenly on the defensive against the police and even the FBI.
The day that we were at Lincoln High School, first blowout, there were guys with suits on, with cameras, taking our pictures. It was part of, I learned later on, part of the FBI counterintelligence program, or COINTELPRO, that had been created to deal with the civil rights movement and the black poverty. And documents that I got also showed the infiltration of movements and Chicanos and organizations.
The Brown Berets were a special target.
The LAPD at that time was doing surveillance. We were taking a lot of photographs, and we didn't realize this until way later on when we were arrested. We felt it was an attempt to try to stop the movement, the growing movement. And little did we know that the Berets by then had already been infiltrated by the sheriffs and the LAPD.
One of the walkout leaders who said he was from Wilson High School turned out to be an LAPD.
Everyone was suspect. And with good reason, it turned out that a significant number of the people in these various organizations were police officers or informants. Many of them were actually the people who were proposing violent actions.
The officials were keeping tabs on certain individuals, which were then being referred to the FBI on subversive activities, in which I was one of those people who was listed as one of the 100 most subversive individuals in the United States in 1970.
What I started to see was a series of arrests and threats against me personally and other Berets. You know, you got your troublemakers, you're making our people look bad, and we're going to be sure that you spend the rest of your life in prison or you end up dead.
And I began to get these documents as the years went on, doing my research. And sure enough, I got a bunch of documents on myself. And then I realized why it was that that night that I was arrested, that early morning that I was arrested, why I was almost killed. Because in those documents, the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover rest of us, you know, conspirators and protesters, as subversives, dangerous, armed subversives. You know, and my God, all we're doing was nonviolent protest.
As schools opened in the fall, the East LA 13 felt the full impact of their indictments.
I walked in this morning and they told me I could not teach, that I would have to go downtown to personnel, that I could not teach and fall down the principal.
There was a ruling, part of the education code, that if you are arrested, you cannot be in the classroom. And then because I was indicted, I was an indicted felon, for sure I could not be out in the classroom. So I was going to have problems as far as teaching.
A struggle in the East Los Angeles school system came down to a single defining moment. Students and parents fought to get Sal Castro reinstated.
What do you think it will take to get people to pay attention to the demands of the Mexican-American community?
Well, you know, that's a good question. Actually, looking in retrospect, there were about 15,000 kids out in the streets in that week of March. There were about 16 schools involved, not only senior highs throughout East Los Angeles, but also in West Los Angeles, in support of the kids in East LA. There were junior high schools involved. There were about 45 high school students in West, there were about 25 adults. And the majority of the community seemed like it was unconcerned, business as usual.
We picketed that high school every day with contingent people picketing to call for Sal Castro to return to Lincoln. And in between our daily pickets at Lincoln, we also went to the school board meetings, which were on Tuesdays and Thursday afternoons, to address them and ask them to return Sal to Lincoln.
It was Zapata. Zapata who said, "I've got to tell you, my feet, and live on my knees."
After 10 days of picketing without results, Chicano activists resorted to a new tactic. Instead of walking out, they sat in.
And we said, well, we're not going to leave. And we'll sit here and we'll stay here until you make the decision that our needs of the Chicano community and the city are taken care of. And the community has the right to make decisions about the kinds of people who teach in their schools.
It just seemed like the next logical step. You know, we had to kind of apply a little bit more pressure. We were determined to occupy that room. That was our main function. We stood up there, we kept that room occupied through that whole period.
After 7 days, the board agreed to vote on Sal Castro's reinstatement. But they demanded that protesters in the city or be arrested.
That last night, the officers came in and made the announcement that there were going to be arrests, and those of us who didn't want to be arrested had to leave.
35 demonstrators refused to leave.
You are hereby notified that this building will be closed at 10 o'clock p.m. That any permission, implied or otherwise, to remain on these premises is hereby revoked. You will be considered trespassing and in violation of California Penal Code Section 602N.
Los Angeles School Board began to vote as the community watched. Sal Castro and the other LA 13 defendants won their battle with the school district, but they still face the possibility of long prison terms. Their legal battles would continue for 2 more years.
The East LA 13, which was of course the case coming out of the walkouts, was ultimately thrown out of court on appeal, again based on the Bill of Rights. Freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom to petition the government for redress of grievances. The walkouts were the first significant urban
current struggle of the Chicanos. And all that our kids were trying to do was to make the schools work better.
What the Walkouts did, it focused the attention now on the Chicanos in the city, because these kids were serious. These kids had went to school for that time. They were going to do something. They were going to change the world.
Los Angeles was only the beginning. Soon after the blowouts, Chicano students across the country staged similar protests, igniting a movement for educational reform that would continue for many years to come.
We were very successful at informing the public about how serious the conditions were. Also, in getting our parents and other community people involved.
The blowouts made us all realize that now collectively we have a strong voice, and it gave us a power that we didn't realize that we had before. And we knew that we're going to win.
Panelists, if you can make your way to the stage, that way we can start the panel in 5 to 6 minutes. Thank you.
All right, so if folks could find their seats, please, so that we could begin. I'm going to start with brief introductions on each of our panelists, and if our panelists would please raise their hand after I introduce them. So first, I'd like to introduce Iyari Alvarez. She is a senior at Woodrow Wilson High School. She grew up in Westmont. Yeah, give her a shout out. She grew up in an area in South Central. When she was 13, she moved to City Terrace. Her goal is to help students and children impacted by social inequalities, those who are told their future is dependent on where they live and the color of their skin. Her goal is to open a nonprofit organization that helps families thrive in Los Angeles. She's a student that is part of the Law Magnet program at Wilson, as well as a member of the Occidental College's Upward Bound program. She's an active member and organizer of the United Students program that is a youth program of inner city struggle since her sophomore year. She was one of the students who organized and participated in the walkouts against the presidential election. She interned with WIPO, which is a statewide coalition that pre-registers young people to vote and organizes multiple civic engagement programs. So please welcome Yari Alvarez. Next we have Naomi Helena Quinones, Dr. Quinones, born and raised in Los Angeles, and Dr. Quinones currently lives in Oakland. She identifies as a Chicana poet, an educator, and an activist. She graduated from Wilson High School and attended the California State University before finishing her undergraduate work at San Jose State University. Dr. Quinones received her master's in public administration from the University of Southern California and a PhD in history American studies from Claremont Graduate University. She has written 3 books, poetry books, Hummingbird Dreams, The Smoking Mirror, and The Exiled Moon. She co-edited the Invocation LA Urban Multicultural Poetry, which received an American Book Award, and also co-edited Decolonial Voices, Chicano Cultural Studies in the 21st Century. Dr. Quinones also edits journals and magazines such as Caminos Magazine and Chisme Arte Revista. Her creative and critical works are referenced in numerous articles, essays, journals, and others throughout the world. Some of Dr. Quinones' achievements include American Book Award, a Rockefeller Fellowship, and the California Arts Council Award. She was recently
acknowledged and recognized with the award, a Lifetime Achievement Award by the City of Berkeley for her literary contributions. She lectures throughout the U.S. in the areas of ethnic studies, gender studies, and cultural studies, and is a featured speaker and poet in readings and festivals throughout the country and Latin America. Dr. Quiñones served as director of the California Literacy Campaign in Los Angeles and the West Virginia Cultural Institute. She founded the Los Angeles United Latinos in Arts and helped produce Los Angeles Latinos and Poets and the Playwrights Festival. She received the Los Angeles Arts Council Award to produce Mestizo Voices, a multimedia healing program after the Rodney King Uprising. She founded the Bay Area Libro Traficante Network, and she's also a founding member of Los Angeles Barrio Writers Workshops. She offers poetry and literary workshops to diverse communities throughout California. So please help me welcome Dr. Quiñones. Next is Bobby Verdugo. Born and raised and still lives in East Los Angeles, Mr. Verdugo attended UCLA and graduated from California State University of Los Angeles with a degree in social work. Robert, or Bobby Verdugo, is a senior education or la educación specialist with the National Compadres Network, whose mission is to strengthen, rebalance, and or redevelop the traditional compadre extended family system. Much of the focus is on healing and nurturing the safety and health of the families. This always includes their physical, their emotional, their spiritual, and their mental health. In 2013, Bobby was named Vice President of Leadership Development at the Sol Group, Inc., a policy and public affairs firm specializing in strategy, outreach, and leadership. Bobby Verdugo was a leader during the historic 1968 walkouts at Lincoln High School. And also, in addition to that, to the educational and policy improvements, the walkouts brought about a remarkable increase of Chicano enrollment at UCLA, from only 40 students in 1967 to 1,200 students in 1969. He was portrayed in the HBO docudrama Walkout through these events, and definitely he came out in the documentary that you all just previously watched. And because of his work with fathers and families, Mr. Verdugo has been invited to speak at symposiums, conferences across the country. He's been invited to participate in the 2003 International Fatherhood Summit in Oxford, England. And recently, Mr. Verdugo proudly delivered a keynote speech at the 16th annual Latino graduation at the University of Notre Dame. He served as a lead organizer of the Obama Nos Llama 2008 effort in East Los Angeles. Mr. Verdugo was a Democratic delegate for the 45th Assembly District and the vice chairperson of the California Democratic Party Chicano Latino Caucus. Bobby has been a part of CLYLP family since 2007 and continues to plug into that conference. But out of all his achievements, he is a proud family man married to his high school sweetheart, Yoli, who is in the audience, and also is a proud father of two daughters, Monica and Marciela. So please help me welcome Bobby Verdugo. Last but not least is Dr. David Sanchez, who is a student at Roosevelt High School. He was one of the founding members of the Brown Berets and is currently the Prime Minister. Dr. Sanchez was one of the 13 indicted after the Chicano walkouts that you have previously seen in the documentary. He works tirelessly to fight for the rights of Mexican Americans in East Los Angeles and throughout the United States. During the 60s and 70s, besides supporting and helping protect the student protesters, the Brown Berets also rallied to support the farm workers, protested police brutality, and the overrepresentation of Chicanos in the draft and casualties of the Vietnam battlefield. Please help me welcome Dr. Davidson Sanchez. So we'll start with yourself, Dr. Sanchez. Please describe your experience as being one of the 13 indicted.
Well, yeah. I think a lot of people don't realize that what happened was everybody decided that the walkouts would take place, and we had a conference at the Bernard Coffee House, and I started a coffee house when I was in high school. Got the money when I graduated from high school. And at the Bernard Coffee House, we organized the Brown Parade. That's where the Brown was founded, in the coffin. And what happened basically was, we had a conference here with Sal Castro, and everybody was at the coffee house, and we decided that we were going to walk out. I wanted to walk out now. I wanted to walk out in January. I said, we can walk out now. They were voted against me. They said, no, we're going to walk out in June. Basically, what happened was, Wilson, they had a play here, and the play was denied. It was in Barefoot and Park. And students, the actors, of course, the actors got really angry and they walked out. And it came on the news. This was like in March 1st. And we were supposed to walk out. Everybody agreed to walk out in June. So what happened when Wilson walked out from here, because they didn't do their play here, but when they walked out, they came on this little thing on the news, and when I heard them do this, now we gotta move. I said, now it's hot. I said, tell you it's hot. And then not only that, but there was a police agent infiltrated, Robert Lobby, and we infiltrated in the wrong place. And he came over to the coffee house and told the Brown Braves, hey, Wilson walked out. He was infiltrating the school also. Remember, he had a report card from Wilson High School, and he was at LAPD. Anyway, so he came and told us about the walkout here. So I called the Brown Braves and said, we got to go ahead and move the walkout. Now the people are ready. Now people are starting to walk out of their own. So we might as well go ahead and do the walkout. And so the first school that was closed by the coffee house was Garfield High School. So the Brown Berets, we went out there. We had, a lot of people don't understand how it worked. Basically, we had like 15 Brown Berets, which was a doku for people over 18. And we had another 15 under 18, and they were mostly our brothers and sisters that went to Garfield High School. So we had all our brothers and sisters going to the high school anyway. And so because we had that communication, we were able to walk out Garfield, and we were able to walk out Roosevelt, and then that started a chain of domino effect. And so before you know this is big, before you know it, Lincoln's walking out, and then Wilson walks out again, I think. Also Belmont walks out. So all together, about 30,000 students walk out. This is the biggest thing that's ever happened. It was the ring that made the Chicano movement start its movement. And began the movement. The movement began. But it was the walkout that started the Chicano movement, the Mexican American Civil Rights movement. And that's why we have all of the rewards that we have today. That's why they opened the doors in colleges and universities. Because they were closed, they would not hire Chicanos to stay in the middle. Local government would not hire Chicanos to Mexican Americans, they would not hire Raza. And so we opened it. This is the first thing. The students were the ones who opened the door. But primarily, it was because we had all of these students, Brown Berets students, who were in the high school, that helped force the door open. So basically, that's what happened.
Can you describe like what kind of work you did after the walkout? Like, how did you continue the movement from the walkouts and like after Sal Castro got reinstated? And just, I guess, like what happened? I want to know like what happened after the document. You know, like what happened after all this like uprising happened?
I think basically the commitment of the Brown Berets, they say once you're a Brown Beret, you're always a Brown Beret. And the commitment continued on. The fight was not over. We continued. A lot of people who said they were, well, who walked out, they walked out, but we never saw them again. They were no longer active in the community over there. A lot of the leaders, for example, they said they walked out, they weren't around no more. We continued on the fight. The fight continued on. The Brown Berets, a lot of people don't realize that the Brown Berets were a very unique organization, because we had institutions behind us. When we didn't have an institution, we created an institution. For example, the first institution of the Brown Berets was a coffee house. That was in our institution. This is where we planned out the walkout. This is where the walkout was planned out. Even though I went against everybody's plan not to walk out until January, it was hot, it was time to walk out. After that, we created another institution. The Brown Berets created the East LA Free Clinic. So that was our new headquarters, East LA Free Clinic. That was our next institution. Unfortunately, the East LA Free Clinic was stolen from us, and now it's called Ultimate. You know, it's a billion-dollar organization that was stolen from us. We're creating another institution right now called the Mexican American University in Maywood, and we already have our offices set up. So we're creating another institution. So in other words, you've got to have institutions behind you in a movement. And we continued on the movement for many years. All of this, for example, the moratorium, the five moratorium, unfortunately, a lot of people got killed with the moratorium. The moratoriums, the rallies, the mass rallies, I guess the war in Vietnam, many, altogether four people were killed, hundreds of people were arrested during those riots along the Boulevard. Everybody that died, the moratoriums, Liv Ward, Angel Diaz, Gustav Montauk, Ruben Salazar, they're all killed on Whittier Boulevard. It's like a fight for Whittier Boulevard. We're fighting for Whittier Boulevard. We're fighting for our community. But the problem with those mass rallies that we organized, they turned into riots. People wanted to fight. I mean, we couldn't do nothing about it. And there were battle zones. There was battle. People fought on the streets for more rights, for more opportunity, for scholarships, for the right to live without being stopped by the police every single day. It was terrible. There was so much racism in the past, but because Chicanos were willing to go out there and make sacrifices, brown braids, we talked about it at the coffee house. Are we willing to go to prison to break open the schools? And a lot of brown braids said, yes, we are willing to go to prison to break open the schools. And they tried to put us in jail. They tried to give us 66 years. We were indicted. 13 people were indicted, taken to jail. They picked us up. I was all pissed off. They took me to jail. I didn't want to go to jail that night. You know, I saw them coming to the front door of the brown braid office. I saw the LAPD coming to the front door, so I jumped out the back window. I'm running down the street. I got five officers, police detectives chasing me. And I said, I can't get arrested. I just can't get arrested tonight because I was going to my prom. And I had my tuxedo in the car. I can't go to jail tonight. Anyway, they got me and put me in jail. They went and got whipped out. South Catholic, put him in jail. They put 13 of us in jail. And they locked us up. They wanted to give us 66 years of a fine. We were with a beach car case on grounds that we had the right to assemble, we had the right to protest. And we fought the case and we were able to win the case. Anyway, the movement continued on after that. Even though we finally got out of jail, we finally let us go. The movement continued on, the moratoriums, and also the brown braids also did. There's a book now, I wrote Expedition Through Aslan. It talks about all of the events, the system that we used, the systems of organizing, also the way of organizing events. Brown braids are famous for organizing events. For example, and finally we went to Catalina Island. And Cat and I were able to occupy the land for 27 days for the rights of us. We wanted to put a university in Catalina Island. Anyway, Sheriff Kevin again, they threw us off the light by gunpoint. Anyway, there's just so many stories that took place. I can't even begin to explain all of the stories, but a lot of the movement came about because people had conviction, had strong conviction. We saved lives. Brown Braids saved many, many lives over and over again. With the violence in East LA, we went up to 1,200 people getting killed. 1,200 Chicanos were getting killed in the 90s per year. Homicide, killed, murder. 1,200 Chicanos were getting killed, murder in Los Angeles County. And Brown Braids, we went out there in the 90s and we stopped the violence. So over and over again, when there's an emergency, the Brown Braids are there to make the moves to save lives. And it's true, when the Chicano was strong, there was less violence. There was less suicide, there was less crime, because people were thinking about something else. And that's why it's so important to continue on this movement, because this movement does save lives, it does give direction, and it gives identity. The Chicano identity is so important. And this is why we have people going insane out there in the streets, and people killing themselves, and doing violence and crime, is because they don't have the identity. They lost the identity. So that's why it's so important to bring back the Chicano identity, and the Brown Braids are the vanguard. They have been the vanguard and still are the vanguard. The vanguard is the front line. People are willing to go a little forward to make an example, to send a message, to make impact on society, and to make change. And that's what the Brown Braids do, and that's what we have done.
A lot of leaders, you know,
are usually victims or witnesses of things that genocide, witnesses or victims of oppression. When I was growing up, I grew up in the middle flats as a youngster. Later on, I was able to get my PhD. But several people got their degrees from the body. Rick, Rick's brother, he got his degree. I got my degree. I grew up in the body, spines, with the body too. So I started the body, not because I wanted to. I got drafted into the game. I got forced into it. But I learned a lot of techniques working in the body. I learned how to deal with bullies, how to deal with oppression. And what happened was I got stopped by the police. Okay. And they harassed me many times. I mean, I got jumped and beaten several times. The first time I got jumped and beaten by a black man. And they put me in the hospital. I was in no gang at the time. I was just, a good student. I was about 13 years old. I was not in a gang. Okay. And I got jumped and beaten by a black man because they were looking for Mexicans to meet up at the time. There was a war going on between blacks and browns in South Central LA. And I really got really messed up. And so finally I came out of it. I got jumped and beat again by a Mexican gang, the Dukes. They're a Mexican gang, and for no reason they just jumped and beat me again. And then the third time I got jumped by a white gang. I got jumped by the LAPD. And every time I was a victim. I was a victim of this modern world. Just like these poor kids that got killed over the school shooting. I was a victim. And I said, something's wrong with our society, the way they treat us. And the only way you have rights is by protesting, is by standing your ground, by holding your ground, and creating a vanguard so they don't continue to step on top of you. For example, what's happening in Hollywood. Mexican Americans and Ross are not hired in Hollywood because you don't need to fight for them. And so we're trying to get more actors involved. And we're also making films, we've been making a lot of videos. We've made a lot of videos. Just look at Brown Brace on YouTube. We think we put together like 6 videos. And we're gonna get getting more creative and better at it. But once again, if you do not have the heart to put us on, look for the corazón. I don't care where you go to see the Wizard of Oz, but get the corazón, because that's what we need. We need corazón for the people. We need people who are willing to stand up for the people, to have strong conviction. And that's what's happening, no conviction. A lot of these schools, what do they teach? They teach a lot of math, but that's about it. What about what's going on in the world? Unfortunately, a lot of these schools are, gringoized, anglicized. And by creating the Anglo person, the Anglo person is not a loving person in many cases. At least it has not been the case in our community. And so we're trying to say that we need to bring back heart, we need to bring back soul, we need to bring back education, Chicano education. Okay, we need to bring back all that thing that made the movement strong as it was before, so we can save lives, so we can create opportunity, so we can save the children so that there will be jobs. There may be no jobs in 20 or 30 years from now. There may be no more jobs because everything's going automation and they're moving us out away from the job market in many cases. So we need to fight, and you need to fight to secure your future. You need to secure the future of the community and your future. I think that was the other thing that I realized. We're not going nowhere. We were in a high school, and we were saying, we're not going to go nowhere if somebody doesn't open the door. And so it was for us to go out and take the guidance and open the door, because if we did not open the door, we would probably be dead right now. A lot of us would be dead right now. But we did do the walkouts as the first gate opener to open the door for the Chicano movement, to open the door for opportunity.
So I really want to honor the stories that Dr. Sanchez has just shared with a chant. So I am going to say que viva, and you all will respond la raza. So que viva!
La raza!
Que viva!
La raza!
Que viva!
La raza!
Thank you. Our next panelist that I'd like to propose questions to
noches, good evening, everybody. I, 15 years ago, I walked out. So, and why? Because what was going on at Lincoln and other schools during that time. And I was real energetic back then. I was 17. I walked out vigorously and with energy. Now I got to use that walker to walk. But it's okay because todo sigue, you know, the movement continues because of our youth, you know, and this is the legacy of what the walkouts of 1968 did and has become. What was going on at Lincoln, I can only speak for myself, and I can share with you what was going on at Lincoln for me. I was 17, I was a senior in 1968, and I was thinking about dropping out. Because the years prior to that, and Lincoln used to be a junior and a senior high school, so I was there since the seventh grade. I came from Griffin Avenue, I grew up in Lincoln Heights, just over the hill. Went to Griffin Avenue Elementary for all those 6 years, and then I started Lincoln High School for another 6 years of education. And I was a bright kid, and I was a sharp little kid. I was a cute little kid, you know? I did really well in elementary school. You know, A's and B's, I scored really high on the IQ test. In fact, I scored in the top 15 percentile of the city of LA as a fifth grader. So I was doing well and feeling good about myself, because a lot of us kids are very curious and ready to learn. You know, we're born eager to learn a lot of things. And I had good parents who taught me. My mom was a high school graduate from Lincoln High School in 1945. My dad, pobrecito, he dropped out of school in 10th grade. So he didn't teach me a lot of academics, but he taught me what it was and what I should do to prepare myself to be a man. And he taught me what it was to prepare myself to be a father. So I had two wonderful parents. But unfortunately, when I got to Lincoln High School in the seventh grade, all those wonderful teachings and even the good teachers that I had, because I had many in elementary school, I didn't find them there at Lincoln High School. That's what was going on at Lincoln. It seemed like nobody was interested in teaching me. There was a disinterest. And what the other thing I noticed is that I was surrounded by, because when in the 12th grade I noticed it because I was going to drop out, but I was noticing that there was a large population of the school that was disappearing. But what I later learned to find out was that Lincoln High School, just like Wilson, and although those numbers have changed drastically, but Garfield, Roosevelt, and even Belmont were all experiencing a 50% dropout rate of the young students. Those of us who entered in the seventh grade were in an auditorium, and we could have very easily waved to one half of the room at that meeting, and what we would be doing was waving goodbye to them, because by the 12th grade, they would have disappeared. They would not have been there graduation day 6 years later. And that was me. I was part of that group that disappeared. So why? I thought it was me. I thought I was stupid. I thought I was an underachiever. I thought I was not worth the time of those teachers who kept telling me that why am I even in the classroom? I'm not going to learn anything, and nothing's going to become of me. And I started to believe it, and I started to think it was my fault. So my days at Lincoln, I have a lot of fun memories. I met my girlfriend, Yoli Rios, who is now my wife. We've been together since 1968. Go ahead and give us a clap. But, you know, good memories. Like, I loved cruising down Whittier Boulevard. I was just a regular kid. I mean, we did a lot of travesuras. We did a lot of good things, you know. And I had a lot of good friends. But I also have some pretty bad memories of being told that I was stupid, that I wasn't going to amount to much. And it started to wear on me. It started to beat me down to the point that when I got to the 12th grade, I had pretty much already given up on myself because I thought I had failed. Well, during the months before the walkouts, we started meeting. I went to many of the meetings over in La Piraña and other people's houses, like Sal Castro's house and Ralph Cuaron and other people who were parents and teachers who were talking to us about how bad the schools were. Well, you know, we didn't realize we were having a good time, but then we started to think about, well, why am I dropping out? There must be something wrong. And again, I started pointing the finger at myself, thinking I was a failure. Well, I quickly learned that it wasn't just me. I take my responsibility for my actions and what I did as a young man. Because I could have done better, but I chose not to because, like I said, yeah, pa que? Why should I? But then I started seeing that I wasn't the only one. That 50% wasn't just a statistic. Those were friends of mine who had disappeared, who were no longer there. They either dropped out, they became teen fathers, they were incarcerated, they were in gangs, or they were dead. And I was on my way to becoming all of the above. Until I found out I'm not the only one. And it's not only at my school, because at those meetings that we were having there, and La Piraña, and at other locations, including the Chicano Leadership Conference, camp with Sal Castro in Malibu, that was depicted in the movie, we started talking to other students, and we realized, you know what? That stuff is going on at all the schools on the east side. There's a 50% dropout rate at the other schools. It can't be that many of us that are stupid. That can't be the reason. There's got to be failure, not only by us, but by the school system. So, what I saw was that something had to be done. A lot of us saw that. That's why we started to organize. We had two choices. We had a lot, two basic choices. We could do nothing, let it continue, let this bullshit continue that was going on to me and to other students, or we could do something about it. And we decided to organize the walkouts. And again, we were 15, 16, 17 years old. We were children, we were kids, just like the kids that got killed in Florida last week. And look what they're doing. They decided that they're not going to just not do nothing about it. They're going to organize. So the legacy continues, and I don't want to draw artificial parallels between what we did back 50 years ago to what they're doing today, because it's totally different, but it's that same pure energy that young people have. I'm glad I'm sitting next to a student here, because this is our legacy. This is what's going to cause the change. So that's what was happening with me at Lincoln High School at that time.
Defining fatherhood, like how did that legacy kind of trickle into the work that you do on an everyday basis?
You know, I've been really blessed that even though I dropped out, I walked out in March, dropped out in May, but in September, October of that same year, I walked onto the campus of UCLA as a freshman student because of Sal Castro. He did not give up on me. He told me about a special program called High Potential Program, which was an affirmative action special admissions program. I got to go to UCLA without a high school diploma. So you would think, oh, what a Cinderella ending. You know, he's a troubled youth, and he gets to go to UCLA. Well, unfortunately, I didn't graduate from UCLA. But I'm not trying to say really didn't learn anything, because I learned a lot those 2 years that I was there. But what I did learn was that myself, I wasn't ready for UCLA. I had, as a social worker that teaches cultura to the young man, and we've done it here on this campus with the Healthy Start program with all the youth, we need to realize that kids, children, students have cargas y regalos, gifts and baggages, or baggages and gifts in our life. We're born pure, we're born sacred, but over the years we develop these cargas, you know, that environmentally or just because, you know, we're affected by what's going on around us. And these young men that I worked with as a social worker since 1995, and I just recently retired, I realized they have cargas and regalos. That's what I learned, and I wanted them to know that even though most people talk about their cargas, oh, your teen father, you messed up your life, it's ruined, you're a failure. That's what I heard when I was 17. I wasn't a teen father, but I heard that same thing. And somehow I was able to overcome that by the help of my parents and teachers like Sal Castro and others that I needed help. And I realized they need help. And I've been blessed that I've been able to provide some of that help for what that we do through the National Compadre Network, teaching young men that we're not going to give up on you. People didn't give up on me, I'm not going to give up on you. We're not going to give up on you. You're blessed that you have a child, and we're going to help you get connected to that child. And we were very, very successful. I say we're because the program doesn't exist anymore. Funding disappeared after 9/11. And just over the years, the program was hard to sustain. But we helped a lot of young men. But those cargas sometimes overwhelm you and overwhelm them. And as many fathers as I can say I help, who can gain some of the confidence like what I do now. And working in schools here on this campus and others, Wilson and Lincoln, we lost some of those guys. Some of those guys were too much. It overwhelmed them. And in those years, 1995 to 2007, when the program practically ended, I can name many who disappeared, but I can name five specifically that were killed. Two by police, two by gang members, and one suicide. And that hurts, because I think they took that reverse and it affected me. I suffer from depression, just like they did. But because I have family that support me, and I realize I can't do the work that I do. I can't help anybody if I don't help myself. That's what I try to teach, and that's what we teach, helping themselves.
And last question, what is your message to future generations to either continue the legacy, like some consejos that you have?
You know, people have been asking, what can we do? Bobby, really, you guys were so brave, so courageous back in 95. I don't know, I was scared. I didn't know what was gonna happen when we walked out, you know? I knew we had the Berets there to support us. We had UMAS, the United Mexican American Students. You know, we had a lot of support from the community. Parents were there. But still, we were kids. And when we walked out in 68, that was only 3 years after the Watts Rebellion. And people got killed in the streets of LA during the Watts Rebellion. They didn't watch out specifically for schools, better schools. It was an issue of poverty, racism, and discrimination that fed into that caused the riots. But over 50 people were killed by the government, right? By US National Guardsmen and police. So you think I was thinking about that morning in March 6th of 1968 when we walked out of Lincoln? I was fearful. But I realized that fear does generate courage. We were courageous only because we were scared. And again, we were faced with just a couple of options. excited. So my message is don't give up. You know, my story has taken a lot of twists and turns. I call it taking the scenic route of life. I didn't go straight to UCLA and graduate in 4 years. It took me a number of years to even graduate from Cal State LA. I graduated from Cal State LA when I was 44 years old. I did a lot. I was a bus driver. I was a body of the bus driver. I drove RTD when you're Metro. I did all that stuff. But I never gave up the hope and the dream of going back to school. And luckily, I got into a profession that I love, social work. So my message to you, all of you, young and old, man, don't give up. Never too late. People didn't give up on me. They didn't let me give up on myself. And I'm not going to let anybody, I'm not going to let you give up your dreams. You know, I'm going to be there. However I can help, you know, so that's my message, you know. Don't give up. It may take forever to graduate from high school. And, you know, good note here, Jennifer knows this story pretty well, because they helped her, the inner city struggle, and Monica Garcia's office. I didn't graduate in 68. I was sitting in the bleachers watching Yoli and all my friends graduate. And they were there on the football field at Lincoln High School, and I'm sitting with their parents, Yoli's parents and all my friends' parents. My parents were not there. I mean, why were they going to see their mingle sit in the bleachers, right? So they had no reason to be there. But Sal, again, never gave up. And on the 40th anniversary of the shirt that I'm wearing today, I think we wore this on March, and we reenacted the Walkouts in 2008. He came up to me and told me, hey, I talked to the principal at Lincoln, he's going to give you your diploma, you know, for the 40th anniversary celebration. I go, well, that's cool, that's so cool, Sal, but that's not what I wanted. My parents are gone now, but what I really wanted was to walk cap and gown. You think you can get him to do that for me, maybe this year? You go, I don't know about that, I have to ask him yourself, and I did, and he told me, that's a great idea, Bobby. I give you permission. I go, well, it's not your permission. I'm, you know, don't want to be disrespectful, but I need a student's permission. I don't want to make a circus out of their graduation. Well, I went to one of their senior assemblies, and luckily they saw the movie, so they knew who I was. And they said, yeah, Bobby, we'd be honored. So in June 2008, I walked cap and gown on that same football field at Lincoln. This time, Yoli and my daughters and my family watched me graduate cap and gown. I'm the second diploma because I didn't actually get the diploma until 2 years ago, but it's okay. The actual Cochinada itself. So that's what it was like at Lincoln.
So to honor Bobby Verdugo's stories, if you all could please help me in this chat. So when I say student, you all say power. So student!
Power!
Student!
Power!
Student!
Power!
Thank you. Next is Dr. Quiñones. And you were here. You were here on the ground at Wilson. So I know you were a student journalist at the time. Describe the atmosphere, the tension, the conversations, the actions that were happening at Wilson, with your friends, with family. What was the atmosphere here on the ground at Wilson that day that they walked out when they canceled Barefoot in the Park?
Okay. Well, first of all, it's an honor to be here. And the last time I was here was on my graduation day in 1969, so it's really kind of tricky to be here again. I wanted to also thank the committee for putting this together. It shows the power of the movement that 50 years later, we are commemorating it. And I think, my deepest respect and gratitude for those of you who have been on the vanguard and got this rolling, because we would never get this in again. Now, is that mine? Is this creating like some noise? Okay. First of all, I wanted to put a little bit of context you know, worldwide. We're talking about a time that there was an incredible paranoia of communism. You know, coming off of World War II, the post-war, Mexicanos, Chicanos have already been enduring events like the repatriation period of the 30s, Operation Wetback of the 50s, the Bracero program. You know, most of the schools at that time had us all on tracks, had Chicanos, Mexicanos, people of color on tracks to not go to college. So, I mean, we're talking about a time that was very restrictive and very oppressive. And yet, you know, there was a lot of contradictions too. Like, for example, in my situation, my father was a World War II veteran. My grandmother was an immigrant from Mexico during the Mexican Revolution. My mom was a Rosita the Riveter. She worked in the defense plants at the time. So here's this anti-communist situation that we're in, this environment that's really volatile, because most groups that were working for social change were targeted as being anti-American. Now, I'm speaking now with 2020 vision, because at the time I didn't know any of this. I was, you know, a student who was, you know, just trying to get my education. I had very strict parents, so it was about, you know, staying in school. It wasn't about going to college, but it was about going to high school. And there was contradictions that were emerging for me at that time. Like, for instance, my grandmother believed in the American way. I mean, her life was better here. That was her experience. My father, a World War II vet, served his country, you know, at the risk of his life, and he expected to be treated like an American citizen, which he was not. And, you know, my mom was probably the most conservative in my family. She was, you know, holding the line that, you know, we've got to be good Americans and all of that. But the problem was we weren't being treated like American citizens. And so the contradictions for me as a young person was, here we are in this world of anti-communist paranoia. I have family saying, you've got to respect your country. But I'm seeing all these things happening around where people are being restricted, and I was not confused as much as I was energized to find out what's going on. It's one of the things that actually, you know, it was this feeling that actually compelled me to become a historian later on in my life, because I did my work on the Chicana role in the Chicano movement. Which is like another story, another part of this story. But during that time, you know, to get back to the tenor of the times, it was very tumultuous, but very exciting. But there was a lot of debating going on. One of my old pal, Carlos Callejos, is here, and I was fighting with you all the time, right? He was an anti-Vietnam activist. And I couldn't understand quite yet what that was about. I mean, aren't we fighting the good fight for the United States in Vietnam? It took me a while to realize that that was not really the case. But at that time, that is what I believed. And, you know, these contradictions were coming to me like, well, you know, we have a limited role in our educational achievement, but we still have an education, right? We could be made low wages as Mexicans, but we still have jobs, right? And all of those things that were coming to a head for me helped me to become more involved in the questioning. And I have to say that that time probably generated the most critical thinking, because we're young. I mean, as Bobby mentioned, and also David, we're young. All of these questions that were coming to our minds, we were debating all the time. Maybe we were fighting with each other too. You know, people were storming the Board of Education, the Los Angeles Board of Education, demanding to know, why don't we have equal education? So there was a lot of excitement at the time as well. One of the things that comes to my mind the most, though, I think that really profoundly influenced me, was this issue of identity, and David brings that up. How important identity was. Who are we? Are we American? Are we Mexican? We're not being treated like American. Where do we belong? And I didn't quite, you know, gel with this idea of the Chicano. Oh, God, that word Chicano, where did that come from? It turns out to have more indigenous connotation. And with time, I learned the beauty of our indigenous culture, and I embraced it fully. But at that moment, in 1968, I just was questioning, what is my identity? Another issue that came up was the Vietnam War. I was here at this time that friends of mine, relatives, were dying in that war. What were we fighting for? That was the big question. And of course, you know, we had the government, I guess, philosophy or ideology that we're fighting for democracy. But the questions were we fighting for democracy, really? The other part of this was, how come there's so many Mexican Americans who are being inducted into this war, and other people of color and poor people? I, you know, later on I actually wrote some poems about this. More than the percentage of our young men dying in the war was greater than even our population. So there was a lot of conversation about this, like, about the Vietnam War. Also, this idea of revolution, you know, came up quite a bit. And there were a lot of people who were, you know, bringing up the doctrines of socialism, Trotskyism, Leninism. You know, what is that? What does that mean? What is socialism? What is communism? You know, these were questions that were on top of everybody's mind. I can't say that we all knew the answers to those questions, but we sure were interested in finding out. Also, this idea of inequality. What's up with inequality here? You know, why, after so many years of our people giving this country through the exploitation of their labor, or, you know, they're serving in Vietnam or World War II, why are we still treated unequally? So the tenor of those times and the atmosphere was very, it was turbulent, but it was turbulent only in that it was agitating our sense of who we thought we were and making us think about who we really are. And that was very disruptive to a great extent. And I think that's what helps us. Those questions like that help shape us to our core. And I think the real revolution starts exactly with that, with people who ask themselves the hard questions and then spend their life trying to find out the answers to those questions. There was a lot of, resistance on my part to ideas like the walkouts initially. And I wasn't sure why we would be walking out of college, out of high school, if we wanted an education. But actually, it didn't take long for me to understand that we couldn't have changed our position in terms of receiving unequal education without the walkouts. So as you watch the film, you could see the stakes were very high. I mean, it really brought out the police state in this society. It really brought out the anti-American reaction to the actions of these young people who were questioning and challenging the system. So, to a great extent, I have to say that it was my initial coming of age to my political identity and to my cultural identity that I feel that I was sharing with many, many other young people of my time.
Thank you. And I really appreciate how you mentioned the evolving identity, and that you brought up that your study began to focus on the Chicana experience and the Chicano movement. And, you know, now in our time,
Miami Dade, we've seen the identity evolve to Chicanx. You know, when I was at UC San Diego, part of the Mecha chapter there, we were saying Chicanao with the arroba, you know, the at sign. And then we were challenged, like, you know, well, does that include everyone? Does that include the binary of a female and male? You know, like, what about the X, and how does the X also include to the connect to the indigeneity that you also mentioned too? Like, where does that word Chicano come from? What has been your experience with this evolving identity, or kind of like the conversations of the evolving Chicano, right?
One thing that I've learned is that our struggle is a vigilant struggle. I mean, it really never ends. And I think some part of our limitations in a protracted struggle is that sometimes we think, okay, that's it, we made it. So by the 1980s, when Ronald Reagan came in and literally removed this, or punished people for using the term Chicano or Black or Black Power, and then tried to get more, you know, Chicanos to become Republicans, and many did, the term kind of dropped off, and what got replaced with was Hispanic. And then we have a generation of young people who are now relating to the word Hispanic. So once again, we're removing ourselves from our indigenous roots. So, you know, it's ongoing. We have to use our education and our opportunities to inform people about, we have the right to be proud of an incredible history that we have from the Americas. I mean, this is, it's not just the United States. We live on a hemisphere that is Las Americas, and the larger population of Las Americas are indigenous people and Mexican people. And we have to remind ourselves of that, or we could easily drop off into, you know, believing that we're part of something that we have not yet been given the right to be part of. And we unfortunately, in many ways, remain as second-class citizens. And that was an issue back in the day as well. We're second-class citizens. You know, we're citizens, those of us who were born here, but we're second-class citizens. And what that means is that we don't really have all the rights of the, you know, equal education, financial mobility, being where, living our dream of where we want to be without a lot of resistance from other forces. So it's a protracted struggle. We have to be vigilant. We can't really afford to just drop off and say, well, okay, I think we need it now, and we're here. I do have to say that a couple of things that really changed me radically was the assassination of Ruben Salazar. Because here was a man that I respected so much. He was a journalist during the Chicano movement, and he was covering the movement. And he was getting, he was working for the Los Angeles Times, and he was getting a lot of flack from the powers that be, because he was taking that role. So during the Chicano moratorium, when he went into the Silver Dollar Cafe off of Whittier Boulevard, and the sheriffs shot a projectile canister directly at his head and killed him, and then we were forced to watch a kind of kangaroo court, and unfortunately, where nobody was indicted for his murder, that really turned me around, you know, because it was something so obvious to so many of us who respected him. And he wasn't even really considered a radical, per se. He was somebody who was covering, he was definitely a progressive. The other thing that turned me around was the Vietnam War. It was just, you know, this perpetual sacrifice of young people into a war that just, you know, seemed to be endless. And, you know, it finally ended in 1974 with the resignation of President Nixon. But, you know, it did so much damage to my generation and the generations before me of men and women who were profoundly maimed by that mentally and physically. And so that really turned me around too. And the third thing that turned me around was learning about my culture, learning about, you know, the Nahuatl culture, the Mayas, the Incas, the languages, going to Mexico, seeing, connecting with my ombligo to a certain extent, you know, my roots. That was extremely important for me to understand that we have a legacy of intelligence, of writing, of mathematics, and we need to remind ourselves that we are descendants of that. You know, we have the powers to do that as well.
And I guess just last remarks, like I've asked Bobby, consejos to future generations and the generations now that are organizing. What are some of your advice?
Well, there's going to be folks like me who didn't initially jump into the movement, and I think, you know, we have to exercise certain strategies that, you know, help people understand that there are reasons to get involved in their community. That could be, you could use history, that's an extremely important part. You know, patience. I mean, there are going to be some people who never change. You know, they're very fixed in their attitudes. But work with people who are open, who are ready to be proud of themselves, you know, who are ready to say, I'm not, you know, as Bobby mentioned, you know, I'm not a failure, it's not me, it's, you know, this entire system that we're part of. And to be vigilant, once again, you know, a movement doesn't, like ours, it just doesn't really ever end. I mean, today we see this incredible backlash against immigrants. You know, it's extremely disturbing that we're almost reliving a 1930s atmosphere where people are being deported and separated from their families. We can't really afford to just be in the background and hope and pray that, oh well, you know, maybe things will change tomorrow. We need to be engaged today. So the most that we can do to help people understand that they have something to be proud of and that we have a future that is based on wanting social equality right now is a very important part, I think, for organizing.
Thank you so much, Dr. So like the new panelists, you already know I'm gonna do a chat. I'm gonna switch it up. So when I say si se, you say puede. So si se,
puede.
Si se,
puede.
Si se,
puede.
Woo! So for our last panelist, last but not least, a student that I personally worked with, just building up her skills, and you know, she is an amazing student, super smart, super woman. So I guess first question, you know, what organizing efforts are you involved in that connect to the 1968 Chicano Blowouts, and why is it important for your peers to get involved and just, you know, be in spaces that they can feel empowered?
Not knowing what it was, I was in a leadership conference in Garfield High School. I was invited by one of my friends, and I met with one of the site organizers from Garfield. Her name was Sophia. She told me that she was going to talk to someone at Wilson Jingle so that I can be part of the United Students program, our organization. JMO got in contact with me, and that's where everything started. It initiated with me not knowing much about myself. I didn't know much about my culture, about Latina culture, about anything, until I was introduced to JMO, and she slowly, her and the program, slowly started showing me who my people were and who I could be. And well, there I identified with Latina, and I became so proud of my culture. We have to be proud of what my people have done and who we are as a whole. I then began working with Wilson with the campaign for a wellness center. We We don't have a wellness center at Wilson because there was apparently no funding from it. So we worked with that, and then we worked with the school climate bill of rights. This was very important for me because I felt like so many people get taken advantage of because we don't know exactly like our rights, what we can and can't do, what people can and can't do to us. The school climate bill of rights was a bill, right, that was passed to give us as students a variety of rights that many people don't know about. And since we don't know about it, many administrators or just school police, just anyone, we're able to take advantage of students and we're able to like point us to things that probably we weren't even doing. For example, like when it came to like the school's searches, when they would search our backpacks, and well, connected to the fact that somebody walked out, I think with the punitive practices and the punishments that they would receive, it kind of ties together with how we practice our rights now and how we understand that these people like can't do these things to us anymore because we're human. We can do what we want and have, I mean, like have some sort of motivation to learn in our schools now. We're not, we're not being targeted anymore for the color of our skin or for where we're from. And if we are, like they're not, they don't know us. Can we talk about why is school climate bill of rights important? The school climate bill of rights, it's important because, well, like I said, many people don't know their rights, and knowing your rights gives you this sort of advantage. It gives you a step up to the treatment that you receive and the treatment that you give to other people. To me, it's like you basically just know, you're just educated, you're informed in your rights, in your own rights on your campus where you spend 4 years of your life.
The next question I'd like to ask is, I know you walked out when Trump was announced president. Tell me a little bit more about that. I know folks in the audience have probably only seen social media or have seen in the news, but for you on the ground on that day of what was going through your head, how did you feel empowered? And yeah, just tell us what was happening for you as a student at Wilson when that went down.
Well, I'm so grateful to be here with people. It's a very big motivator for me. That day at the walkouts, it was surprising to me. I shared it with a couple friends, and they were like, why are you gonna do it? What was the point of it? And in my head, I was thinking, well, don't you know, you have a voice too. Nobody's just going to do something for you if you don't speak it out, make it into existence. The significance of the walkouts for me was sort of to show how far we've gotten. We were not beaten that day, we were not arrested. We were just peacefully protesting. We were walking the streets of Los Angeles, chanting, we were yelling, we were singing. It was a very beautiful experience to me. I shared it with my family and they didn't agree with it. They're like, you better stay in school, don't walk out, but I did it anyway. It was funny, I walked out of my class and my teacher, he didn't say anything, he agreed with me. He thought it was good for me to be kind of doing this social movement. I made posters in that class and he didn't tell me anything. I walked out and I just see like the security guards and the principal stopping at the double doors and they weren't letting people out. And I kind of sort of like just dodged him. I went around him and I was like, you can't stop me. So I went around him and I left the school. And outside there was Semillas del Pueblo. It's a high school on Huntington Drive, right? They're a charter school, I believe. They were chanting. They were saying Semillas walked out, Wilson walked out. And then you just see people, a whole bunch of people just walk walking down Road 51, and I just see groups of people walking down to Wilson. And I was with my best friend, and we were just chanting, "Wilson, walk out, Wilson, walk out." And there we started walking to Lincoln Park. Yeah, we walked to Lincoln Park. And there you just see like hundreds of other students together, united, and there was people who spoke about their own experiences at their schools, and then we walked to the downtown, to City Hall. And that experience was crazy. You just see like thousands of people there, teachers, parents, the news station. And it was so crazy to see how many people came together because of social media, because we have this ability to share everything in touch of our hands to people all over the world, all over the city. And all these people came together and they fought for what they thought wasn't okay. This presidential election to me was, I did not agree with one bit of it. I don't like to call him President Trump, I like to call him number 45. I've heard a lot about the racial slurs and the bigotry that he's committed. Just things that he said about not even just brown and black people, but of people who are Muslim, people who are from other races that are not like him, people of color. He tied us together. He said that, I'm going to quote one thing that he said. One of quote was saying that he has suggested that Obama's protection of the Dreamers, otherwise law-abiding immigrants who were brought to the United States illegally as children, contributed to the spread of MS-13, which is a widely known gang. In December of 2015, number 45, he called for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States. That's another thing with the Muslim ban. So this is why I walked out. I walked out because I don't want to promote or I don't want to justify his racism and just the violation of our First Amendment. So it's like that day was amazing to me to see how many people came together and they all spoke for what they believe in. They all chanted, they all just came together as one, regardless of where you're from, regardless of what school you go to, or what your race is. We all came together and we all were there for what we thought was not wrong, not right. I know,
the county passed the resolution to fund a legal defense department. Also the school board, the LAUSD school board members passed another resolution to not cooperate with ICE, to not easily cooperate with ICE, and to also identify sex sanctuary spaces. So definitely to the walkout that you all led, the youth led, there's tangible changes that are going on, right, that are protecting students who identify as Muslim, our LGBTQ+, our dreamers, right, our undocumented brothers and sisters. So I definitely, I'm so inspired by, and this wasn't even coming from adults, right? I was there as a peacekeeper, right, and we were just between the police and the students walking out. And when the students came, and said, "We are gonna walk out," we were like, "Oh my God, it's happening, they're gonna do it." We were just there for you all. I'm so proud that you all exercised that right and that you all continue the legacy from 1968 walkouts. I know this has been a national conversation around the shooting that happened in Florida, and a lot of students are calling upon other students to walk out. What would you say as from a student perspective, how to, create a safer community, a safer school, so that we can prevent mass shootings like this?
For this mass shooting, it was really disappointing to see that number 45 himself, he wasn't necessarily concerned directly with a route of action that he can take to necessarily what actions can be taken to prevent things like this happening. I've read a lot about conservative ideas where we give teachers guns instead of regulating gun control, which is absurd to me. Honestly, I feel like teachers, yes, they do have to say what goes on in the classroom or not. I don't think they can use the power to keep my life in their hands. If they can educate someone to easily just go and shoot a student for leaving before the bell rings. I feel like this is not providing a safe and stable environment. If my teacher doesn't have a gun because they made him, I wouldn't go to school. I would rather just become a little home school and be independent study. Because that doesn't seem like a reason. I feel like why is there more guns? Which promote violence in most cases, rather than just control who we send to, where we send our bodies. Being raised in South Central, I was raised in South Central. I went to Brent Park Middle School for my 6th to 7th grade year, and I also did a couple of months at Washington High School. There's a lot of tension with Black and Brown students there. We see that the violence that is still ongoing. Many times there's just like wars between them, where Black students and Hispanic students tend to fight over resources or territories or who's stronger than who. this is where I connect this with the school shooting. There needs to be more resources where we bring togetherness instead of thinking as separate. I feel like the main solution to this is to bring us together. There isn't an excuse as to why we're still fighting with each other. We're all students. We're all there to learn. We're not there to fight. We're not there to pick up someone else because they're a different color of skin. With the restorative justice thing, that's a way that our school has helped to bring people together. We've implemented restorative justice when it comes to like students who are at risk. That's what we call it, I think. Where we bring them in and we help them. And there's people who talk to them, there's people who can relate to them and seek a way to find a solution to their problems, I guess. There's different ways that we can just basically do that. We're done. We don't know anything outside of school. And if we do, it's because we live in the streets. So having teachers who can relate to us is a big help because they know what we are going through and what we will go through following high school. But just coming together as a teacher, as a student, as an administrator to our school, having us relate to one another is a big step. Creating a solution to the separate that we have in our schools.
And you're part of our future generation. What are your goals, your aspirations? If you could share any with us.
I have siblings who are currently living in poverty, and two little brothers who live in South Central. They do not go through stuff for younger. And going to school is a place where they don't really care what they do. They just give a little package work and they tell them to go sick. And my little brothers, when I ask them what college they want to go to, but what they want to be when they grow up, they say they don't want to go to college. They say that they don't want to go to college because it's too expensive, because it's too far, because their mom didn't go to college. They're not motivated because they don't see outside of the 5-block radius of South Central Los Angeles. They don't see how good the police can be. They don't see how Martin Ridge or Sacramento or out-of-state schools can benefit them. They motivated me to want to open my own nonprofit to help students like them, K-12, to show them that there's something outside. Just like what United Students is doing, they showed me that there was something outside of my cultural barrier that I was creating for myself, because
honor Yadi's stories, I am going to say, se ve, se siente. And if you all reply, la lucha está presente. Se ve, se siente. Se ve, se siente. Se ve, se siente. Thank you all so much for our panelists. Thank you for your stories. If you'd like to stay up here, we're going to do a photo opportunity later. So to wrap up this event and to also honor another powerful organizer, we would like to dedicate a certificate, Impact on Community and Social Justice, to a legendary leader. They were born in Boyle Heights and moved to El Sereno in the 1950s. They went to San Gabriel Mission High School and then Cal State LA. They were the founding president of the United Mexican American Students, also known as UMAS. They initiated the Chicano Studies program and also the beginnings of the early opportunity programs at EOP to recruit more Chicano students at Cal State LA. UMAS was one of the groups that Sal Castro outreached to also support the student walkouts, and of course UMAS was on board with it, and UMAS was also, some of the members were part of the East LA 13 that were indicted. This person also taught at Cabrillo College in Santa Cruz, and they also worked along farm workers movement, the lettuce strike with Cesar Chavez in Watsonville and Salinas. They participated in the California Chicanos for Higher Education group and helped put together the Plan de Santa Barbara, a plan for Chicano studies across the whole state and not across the whole nation. They also taught at the University of Utah in Salt Lake City. They came back to Los Angeles and worked with One Stop Immigration, a group that was sponsored by the City of LA to protect the legal rights of immigrants and to fight for their defense. They lived in the 80s, but then they also came back and started to teach at the Claremont Graduate University and taught at the infamous Heman Stark Juvenile Maximum Security Prison for young men between the ages of 18 and 21. And that was noted as their most impactful time that they, taught, men of color in this really, dark environment. And also they taught at Cal State Fullerton in the Chicano Studies Department and was the advisor for MECHA. In 2013, then, and a good friend, Gilbert Salcedo, started the Foundation for Economic and Social Justice, whose main purpose is to fight poverty. And their organization has worked with many people. They've worked with the Eastside Cafe here in El Sereno. They've worked with the street vendors here in Los Angeles to protect their rights. They also worked with the city of Pasadena to secure their status as a sanctuary city. And they are small right now, but they are growing. Growing in the sense that they are able to give out scholarships to students from Roosevelt, Garfield, Wilson High School, and to continue their dreams onto higher education. If you could please put your hands together and help me welcome Philip C. Mascarita. On behalf of Inner City Struggle, the Wilson Mills Alumni Association, and the El Sereno Historical Society, we'd like to give you the certificate of recognition. Thank you. Would you like to give some words to the crowd? I know I briefly mentioned all the legendary work you do. But yeah, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It seems like a long time ago, maybe because it was. But realize that the walkouts began here at Wilson High School. Here. Later on, it went to Garfield, Lincoln, and Roosevelt. But it started here. Wilson forced everybody else out. Actually, I was one of the peacekeepers at Garfield High School, keeping the police away from the Garfield students there. But I wanted to say very quickly that not everybody is recognized for all the work they did in our social movement, in our Chicano movement. We hear David, we hear about Bobby, we hear about Sal, but there's several many others that were included in this struggle that I never recognized. They deserve honor too and recognition. It was a community that did this movement. Realize, we talk about El Sereno, Boyle Heights, Lincoln Heights, but at that time, we were one big body. Belmont, we were all a community without borders, if that means anything to you today. We had no borders. We were all together in the struggle. Realize, please, that there were people who never picked up a picket sign before, who were marching in picket signs, who were struggling against the police. We did. We can do it still, because it's needed still. And I hope you walk away feeling that you have that power. Realize what El Sereno has. The Semillas del Pueblo. Who else has a school like that? Who else has the East Side Cafe except El Sereno? That's very powerful. Please be aware of the strength we have as a community right here in El Sereno. El Sereno Viva. But let me close by saying very quickly, educación es liberación. Si otro mundo es posible, vamos todos nosotros adelante hasta la victoria siempre. Muchas gracias.
Our grand event, I'd actually like to ask all of you to stand up and if we could do the Unity Clap. And for folks that have never done the Unity Clap before, it starts off slow and then fast, and we'll end the tonight, which is really, really powerful and very, very connected with the words of Mr. Castorita. So we'll see you inside. Our next event is Thursday, March 1st, in front of El Sereno Middle School. Thank you.